Okay, so the Logic app's actually made up of three components. I only have slides for two of them. I'll only briefly mention the third. But the first piece is the Logic app designer. And the Logic app designer, this is the part that you're probably more familiar with at this point, given some of the demos. This is this nice visual designer that you have to build your workflows. This is one of the great things about Logic apps, is that it does a lot of great things for you automatically. It automatically generates the correct inputs and outputs, can do simple mapping, lets you do control flow. But let me explain a little bit about how the designer works and what it's made up of. So the Logic App Designer is a TypeScript, JavaScript, or React app. So Facebook has a framework for building TypeScript applications called the React.js, and that's actually what the designer is. So on your browser, on your device, that app is running fully. Everything you need is running inside of your own browser to do all of the designer things. You just download that JavaScript app or TypeScript app, and then it runs on your browser. And this is what enables us to do things like host the designer within Visual Studio, have the designer be hosted in other clients like Power Apps or Microsoft Flow, is because it is this contained app in itself, this TypeScript app. In terms of generating those nice inputs and outputs, so that if I'm saying send an email, I may see a to field, a from field, and a subject field. All of that is just generated by looking at OpenAPI or Swagger to render the inputs and outputs. So if you're not familiar, Swagger gives you a way to describe an API, explain what its operations are, what the inputs and outputs are. All this TypeScript app is doing is it's going and looking at Swagger for different connectors or operations and rendering the card. That's pretty much all it's doing. And then on top of it, obviously, it is doing some dependency and graph management so you can chain things together. But at its core, the designer is pretty simple. Obviously, there's some complexity baked in to do more advanced things. But it's really just saying, go look at these different Swagger documents, render them cleanly, let me build a graph, and that's all it does. Obviously, why it's valuable, though, is because of this last step, which is that it generates a workflow definition. So unfortunately, you can't take a screenshot of a Logic app and publish that to Azure and expect that the backend will know what to do with it because the backend doesn't read pictures. So the designer generates this workflow definition, which is a big JSON object, which is pretty much just the data model for your workflow. And it generates that because that's what gets published into Azure, and that's what the backend reads and understands and knows how to process. So that's the designer. It's pretty much separated from everything else. Its job is just generate a valid workflow definition so that you don't have to write this workflow definition by hand. And you can see that workflow definition when you click that code view button in a Logic app. You'll see what it's generating. Okay, so now let's talk about the second component, which is actually the Logic app runtime. So this is the thing that actually executes your Logic app after you've designed it. So what it does is it looks at that workflow definition that the designer has created, and it breaks it down into a series of different tasks. So each of those different boxes within a workflow is a task. So it looks at that definition, it says, okay, I've got 50 tasks in this workflow, and then it will chain dependencies as well. So I can't execute task 38 until tasks 1 through 37 are done first. And maybe I can do task 2 at the same time I do task 1. So that's the first thing it does. It kind of looks at this, breaks it into a series of tasks, and understands the dependencies with it. How it works behind the scenes is we do have a distributed model where any worker across a vast series of compute nodes can complete those tasks. So that distributed nature is very important because it explains some of the behaviors on how your Logic app executes, including this, what was mentioned briefly in the last session, at least once guaranteed execution. So when you're using a distributed model and we're assigning different workers to accomplish different tasks across an entire scale set of virtual machines and compute clusters, it means that we can't take your workflow and say, we will only ever do an action once and only once. In the vast majority of the time, that's what happens. But we'll see as I break into this later, you do have at least once guaranteed execution and not only once guaranteed execution. But we do guarantee you will at least get one execution. There is no active thread management. Since this is distributed, we're really just assigning tasks in a distributed model. It means that you can have tasks and runs that are running in parallel at massive scale, because we'll just spin up workers across the entire cloud to accomplish your work. So if you want to trigger off thousands of runs and those thousands of runs need to happen at the same time, that's fine, because we're just going to assign thousands of workers across the cloud to do that work for you. So that's from a high level. Let me break this down and walk it through kind of step by step. So this is an example of a workflow. It's very simple. It's going to get a message from a service bus queue. It's going to do the peak lock pattern so that it doesn't erase the message from the queue. It just locks it and says, I'm going to process this. And let's say that this message is an order, like an order from a grocery store, to keep the example simple. Okay? So that order will have many line items, maybe bread, eggs, milk. Okay? So the first step in my workflow is a for each loop, and it will say for each line item. For each line item, insert a row into SQL. So when this runs, after it gets a message, let's say I have eggs, bread, and milk, it will do an insert row, once for eggs, once for bread, once for milk. So I'm going to have three inserts. Once all of those are done, it has the last step, which is complete the message, which says, I successfully processed it, mark this message is gone, so nobody else picks it up. So let's see what happens here in the Logic app when I run this. So the first thing I do is I click that save button in the designer, and our designer is going to generate this workflow definition language. And it's going to take that workflow definition, that JSON object, the kind of the code view representation of these four steps, and it's going to push that into the cloud. And the first thing that that's going to start off is it's going to break this into a series of tasks, and often the very first worker that we assign is a trigger task, because I have a trigger here when a message is assigned in a queue. So we're going to say, hey, we need a trigger task. We've got a bunch of work for you to do. And the trigger task is so excited. It's like, yes, my life's purpose. I'm ready to go. All of these workers have very strong personalities as well. I personify them. It makes me feel more connected. Okay. So this trigger task is excited. It's ready to go. And we tell that trigger task, your job is to go check service bus for new messages. And maybe I've defined an interval. Maybe I say, hey, trigger task, every 3 minutes you need to wake up. Go talk to service bus, see if there's a message, and then come back and go back to sleep. With service bus specifically, if I set this to 30 seconds, we'll actually long poll for 30 seconds. So this trigger task will listen for 30 seconds to service bus, immediately listen for another 30 seconds, and immediately listen. So pretty much this trigger task is just constantly listening to service bus, waiting desperately for a message. Check, nothing, check, nothing. It's a very sad life if you never drop a queue item, honestly. So I feel bad for all these dev logic apps where people are just testing it out and they never drop that queue item, and this poor trigger task lives out its life just checking. But if he believes hard enough, and if everything aligns just right, and a message does get dropped in that queue, the trigger is going to see it. It's going to be so excited, and it's going to say, great, I have a message, so now I need to go and start a run. Now, there's kind of a break point in this life cycle of a logic app, because our triggers now told us that there needs to be a run. But does this trigger now get to take some time off, spend time with its family, maybe have a nice cake to celebrate? The answer is no. This trigger goes right back to work. And during the whole rest of this, just remember, this trigger task is always just working away. So because this is distributed and can be parallel, your trigger task is always just running away, so it might be firing off a bunch of other logic apps while we go through this single one. But there is a new run, so we have a new message, and so it notifies the workflow orchestrator, which is this massive service in the cloud that makes sure everything gets done in the right order. And so the workflow orchestrator now looks at this breakdown of tasks, and it says, okay, the first action that I can run right now that doesn't have any other dependencies is this for each action. So it assigns a worker, and it says, okay, for each action, I need you to go do your work. Let me know when you're done. So the for each action starts, and that task starts, and the first thing this for each action says is, what do I need to do? And it sees that it only has one thing to do, which is insert a row. Now, this is an important concept to know. By default, what this for each action is going to do is it is going to say, here's all the rows that I have, just have tasks execute all of them. Which means that you might have a bunch of workers that all in parallel will pick up work items and do them at the same time. So this isn't a for each loop that you're traditionally used to, where you can say X plus plus and it just kind of goes like this one at a time. By default, it will do this in parallel. Now, we actually limit it and we say we'll only ever let 20 workers at a time execute your tasks. But this is one that hangs people up sometimes because they have a for each loop and they're like, why is this all, like, why are things happening at the same time? And it's because we've just said, look, this is all the work I need to be done. And a bunch of workers at the same time pick it up and they all do their stuff independently, limited to 20. We are working on a feature right now where you could control exactly how many workers you want between like 1 and 50 to be working in parallel on your collections. And once all of those individual SQL insert tasks are done, they let the for each thing know. And once the for each thing says that everybody's taking care of all its tasks, it lets the orchestrator know, which going down the line says, okay, well, my next step here is to do a complete a message task. And so it assigns that task, it wakes up, does its stuff, and then it finishes the workflow. Just a few things to point out here in case they weren't clear. The for each task could be done on a completely different machine than the complete message task. And my workflow orchestrator might be on a completely different machine than my trigger task. You have no guarantee where your stuff's going to be executed, just that it will be executed. And we will execute it. Okay? This is a very, the history of the workflow orchestrator is long and rich. It's the same orchestrator technology that powers every single Azure deployment in the Azure cloud, that Azure Resource Manager. So it is a very advanced technology to make sure things are completed, but they will be completed in different spots. And this has some benefits too, because I know when I talk to customers who are looking into Logic Apps, one of the questions they always give me is, well, what happens, like, look, we know the cloud is great and we know it should never fail, but what happens if the machine that my Logic App is running on reboots? Maybe it has a required Windows update that you can't postpone anymore, and it finally just kills in the middle of an important workflow, okay? And that's what they asked me. And if you understand that, look, it's not necessarily a single machine, even if one of these nodes individually fails, another node or another orchestrator across our replication system will notice that something didn't get done and take care of it. So actually, just to illustrate that point, I'm gonna drill into this complete message. And let's show you a little bit more about task resiliency. So let's say on this complete message task, he's running along, living his happy life, and then something happens, okay? A failure of some kind occurs. So there's two kind of failures. The first one is the more nice failure. This is that the task itself didn't fail. Maybe the thing it was talking to had an issue. Maybe it was trying to insert a row into SQL and there was a DNS error returned. It said, I can't resolve this domain, fully qualified domain name or something. Okay, so that's a kind of error. Maybe the connector is being throttled. Maybe you've been inserting so much stuff that the SQL service is saying slow down. Or maybe you get a nasty 500 internal server error, which isn't the task that had an issue. It was a server error saying, you know, SQL's having an issue. Well, in that case, we have what's called a retry policy, where this task isn't just gonna be like, well, the internet had a hiccup, I'm giving up, it's failed. But it will actually wait for a few seconds, by default 20 seconds, and try again. And if it fails again, it will wait for another 20 seconds and try again, and wait for another 20 seconds and try again, and do that 4 times, okay? And this allows it so that if the series of tubes that is the internet has a hiccup, at least your workflow doesn't fail. So it will kind of be able to auto-recover automatically, and you can configure the behavior of your retry policy as well. The other type of failure would be, let's say maybe SQL's up and SQL is fine, but the task itself just died. For whatever reason, we said, hey task, go accomplish this item. And while the task was going, it just vanished. Maybe it abandoned ship and it went to go be a worker on the functions team. I don't know. I don't know how these task lives work. But it could happen, okay? So what happens in that case is the workflow orchestrator is gonna be like, hey, I assigned someone to go do this work ages ago. I haven't heard from him. He might have abandoned ship. So what the workflow orchestrator will do is assign a new task, assign another worker to accomplish that. And that's why you get this at least once guarantee. Because if that happens, it's possible that your first task actually succeeded. Maybe it successfully inserted that row into SQL and then for whatever reason wasn't able to get the message back down the line. In that case, you might have two things that both inserted the same item into SQL. And in that case, you would get, you know, double stuff. So again, this is very, very rare. For the most part, our tasks are very loyal to us. They love us and they always report back. But it is something to be aware of, that is the behavior, is that if we don't get a response back from a task, we will deploy another one, which gives you that at least once guarantee. Okay, and then the third part of the, so this is the runtime. Hopefully that makes sense of how the model works. The last part is the connectors. And I actually don't have a slide for this, but it is worth calling out. Because in this case, we have a service bus connector and a SQL connector and so on. Connectors are more simple in some ways, but connectors are hosted and run separately than this runtime itself. So that is one important note to know. And it also is worth knowing that those connectors, many of them, like Dynamics for Operations, Dynamics CRM, they're actually built and hosted and supported by the partners themselves. So Dynamics team manages the Dynamics connector. They make sure that it scales up and it's able to accomplish the work that it needs. We work with the Service Bus team on the Service Bus connector, the SQL, and so forth. But what that also means sometimes is I got an email this week where today the Dynamics connector had a specific throttle set, where the Dynamics API said, I want to only allow a certain amount of requests per minute. And after that amount per minute, I'm going to start having to return a slowdown 429 throttle response. Now, if you hit one of those responses, you'll be able to see it in your monitoring view. We document all of the connectors and their throttle limits. But the one thing I do want to point out, we're constantly working with the connectors and the different partners to help them lift any limits and make sure that they scale up to whatever our customers want. But it isn't necessarily that these workers aren't able to scale. It's not that we hit our limit and we can't assign any more work. It's really that the connector itself is saying, look, I don't want you to DDoS Dynamics. You can't insert a million things at a time or else you're going to tip everything over for everyone. So that's kind of some detail into where the scaling comes from. So I know that was a lot of detail. I know that's just how you wanted to start your morning. I wanted to make sure we did this one first so everyone was still wide awake for this kind of boring architecture walkthrough. But hopefully that's helpful as well, so that as you're building these workflows, you understand how they work, the guarantees that you have, and the power behind this workflow orchestration, so that we do guarantee. I check with my architect, and this is a fact, at least as far as we know, we have never started a run, ever in the history of Logic Apps for like 2+ years, we have never started a run where each task was not eventually executed. Okay, it hasn't happened, okay? Just because of all the state and the snapshots and the check, and we're always making sure that things are complete. So if we start a run, it will execute at least once as soon as possible. Okay?